9-year-old Metro girl has... In sports, the National Hockey League...
...of sunshine through today with...
Alice in Chains song I heard was probably Man in the Box, but the one that really made me a fan was Wood. I remember the video, Lane with the slick back hair and those bug eye shades. It was striking visually, but then I also really dug the tune, especially the ending. Am I wrong? You know, like melodically, that was a really interesting twist.
A tsunami happened, and you know, Sean gave me a call. He's like, I want to get a bunch of our friends together and I want to throw a benefit concert and, you know, why don't you, me, and Mike get together and we'll play the tunes, you know? And I'm like, I didn't even really think about it. I'm like, absolutely, sure, you know, I'm in.
Yeah, I was just sitting at my house in the mountains and I had this call from Sean and, you know, call to arms. Me and Jerry were on the first flight up to Seattle.
And it was a horrible thing, but to see people respond worldwide and this kind of outpouring of care, you know, and action to help was a pretty amazing thing.
So many people died. It seemed like the worst natural disaster we're going to see in our lifetime, hopefully, you know.
I just wanted to do something to help out. You know, it felt great to play with the guys again and, you know, in public. You know, we'd never had done that since Lane had passed away. And
it was pretty emotional, actually. You know, Lane's parents were there and, you know, all of our family and friends, and of course that's going to bring up a lot of emotions, missing Lane. And so there was probably a couple of good moments in that gig where, and I think the other guys would probably say the same, where I kind of like browned out. You know, after we had done that, you know, then a couple of phone calls started to happen. So we just thought we'd get together and start jamming around in a rehearsal room.
It wasn't ever forced. There was never any call to Jerry or I to each other, like, let's get the band together.
Yeah, the process of this is pretty amazing. I mean, we didn't have a master scheme or game plan or anything like that. Jerry had a lot of great ideas and just turned into these cool jams, you know, that we kind of dug each other's company, you know, and it was just really natural for us to keep going. And picking up Will was a huge thing. And I've never seen a guy like just stand up in front of an audience and look him in the eye and just, you know, not that he's trying to fill those shoes, but just it's just a really ballsy thing for the guy to do, you know.
I had met William at the turn of the millennium. Hit it off with him right off the bat.
First thing Cantrell said was cool hair.
I was working on a record at the time, Degradation Trip, and I was going to go out and tour it around 2002. And I was having a hard time putting a band together, so William and his band actually kind of lent themselves to going out on tour with me and kind of becoming my band.
We'd come out and we'd open the show and then we'd basically just run off stage and towel off real quick and come right back and do Cantrell's set with him.
I'd seen him with Jerry on his Degradation Trip and they'd played some Alice songs and I thought he did those songs justice and made them his own without totally trying to be anybody else.
I was made aware that a few people had come down during the week. I came in there that Friday, and then it was kind of, you know, all right, well what do we want to do, you know? And then, I think it was Cantrell that was like, you want to do Love, Hate, Love?
We kind of wanted to ease in with something a little less vocally challenging, but he wanted to jump right into it, so he picked that one, and we played it, and he killed it.
He did it great, and I was impressed with that.
And Sean looked at me and looked at everybody and was like, well, I think the search is pretty much over.
He's a well-rounded individual.
It was pretty much on at that point. The very first show that I did with them was the VH1 show where they were honoring Hart for their contributions to rock music. And Hart invited Alice in Chains to be a part of their show. It was being filmed for broadcast on television. So, I mean, it's about as deep into the pool as you can get, you know, no pressure or anything. I remember screaming something like, "I want to know who's with us." And I remember this tremendous roar came back.
We got together and jammed, which turned into a couple club shows. And next thing you know, we're standing on stage in like Portugal or Germany playing these crazy festivals in front of hundreds of thousands of people.
You know, the writing of the material was done, you know, in between the tours and stuff like that. And then after we got done with the Velvet Revolver tour, I was really tired, and it was a pretty good long summer tour, and I always do this. I told myself I was going to take a couple weeks off, and I think the first day home I started writing. So
after 2.5 years of touring, we were all very excited to get in the studio because it's really about new stuff and seeing what you're really made of. Of course, I think all the touring we did was necessary to galvanize us as a unit. You know, at the end of every tour, every leg of a tour, we would come home with a little pile of new ideas, you know, and we would always make sure to have someone document it somehow in the moment. So you get home, you got all these tapes, some of them are video, some of them are audio, some of them are voice memo messages on your phone.
Some of the ideas started getting passed around, and so we started thinking, you know, maybe let's go somewhere and get together and flesh out some of these things and see what it sounds like, see what's, if anything's happening here. So we rented a house with a studio and demoed some stuff, and we were digging it.
We started to realize we had some really good stuff.
So we went and took the next step.
You know, and then we started looking for a home for it and found Virgin EMI, and here we are. Here we go.
It was just a question of just our friendship and, you know, saying goodbye to Lance Daly, which is probably a process that will never end for the three of us, you know, but...
The album title comes from the song Black Gives Way to Blue.
A pretty heavy tune. It was a really beautiful song that Jerry wrote for Lane.
I mean, although we dealt with all of that privately and are continuing to do so, the reality of Lane dying and the reality of what do you do with the rest of your life, you know? And I kind of put that into a song, and I guess that was the first time that I kind of said it out loud, you know? And I got really fucking sick. I got really ill.
Like these crazy migraines. I went to all these doctors. I even had a spinal tap trying to figure out what was wrong with him, and there was nothing wrong with him.
And it turned out to be some sort of a migraine episode, I guess, that lasted for about 3 weeks. I think what it was basically coughing up a big chunk of grief, I guess, that I undigested grief that I hadn't processed yet.
When we were tracking that song, Jerry was singing it, and it was me and him and Nick in the studio, and it was just heavy, like a really heavy thing. It was kind of, we kept putting it off. The music was done, we kept putting that song off because we knew it was going to be pretty heavy. And he was singing it, he was having a hard time. And I had like an anxiety attack. I remember I went up in the bathroom and like sat on the floor there and barely breathed, put water on my face. But it was a really, really special moment, you know, because it was such a heavy thing for us.
Those are the kinds of experiences that really forged some pretty deep bonds, I think.
And then we were thinking, you know, maybe putting some piano on it, and our buddy the Baldy was in there, and he said, you know, call Elton. We're like, yeah, right, you know, that's not gonna, sure.
And I just thought that was a crazy idea. I love Elton John, and he's pretty much like the inspiration for me to become a musician. So I wrote him a little note and sent it to him, emailed him, and kind of explained what the song was about, and he said he would do it. Every album experience is completely different, like every album should be, I think. And music kind of reflects where you are at the time, I guess. And it's a lot of years lot of years had passed, and we lost a really good friend and partner in Lane, someone we loved dearly and depended on as a very important member of the band. You know, a lot of the earlier records, Facelift, you know, I mean, God, we were just a bunch of wild kids, man. But this, you know, this record, obviously, there was so many challenges to overcome. You know, everybody really came to the plate. We busted our asses on this record. We put everything we had into it. And I'm really, really happy and pleased with the results.
Basically, I think the central theme about the whole record is us just kind of going through this together and, you know, saying goodbye to our friend and brother and just really special process for me to do this with family as opposed to, you know, just some dudes that play instruments. You know, it's so much more to this thing than you know, that stuff. And just still feels right and, you know, came together. Oh, excuse me.
We all were finding that, you know, it still meant the world to us to play music. Music continues to be the thing that is there for me, kind of evolving, I guess, evolving into what we could be now, and not dishonoring what had gone on before. I just really enjoy being a part of this band. I always have. And, you know, without getting too, like, flowery and metaphysical about it, it just feels like shit's right.